Good afternoon, everyone. We've spent considerable time this semester pondering the essential question of how people become evil, how ordinary citizens become active participants in genocide, how they beat, maim, kill people who were once their neighbors. We've listened to chilling accounts, highly disturbing accounts, of how women suffer in genocide, how rape has been used as a weapon of dominance and dehumanization. But genocide is something we typically think of as conceived, planned, and executed by men. At worst, women are supporters, perhaps comforters, not executioners. So the idea of women as perpetrators isn't really something we've considered until today. Professor Wendy Lauer is the John K. Roth Professor of History and George Roberts Fellow and Director of the McGrublian Center for Human Rights at Claremont McKenna College. Her widely praised book, Hitler's Furies, was a 2013 finalist for the National Book Award. Her work has commanded the attention of genocide scholars and students because, astoundingly enough, it opened up an area of research that really hadn't been very deeply plumbed. Women as perpetrators? Not a popular notion, but a shockingly accurate one. Professor Lauer is here today to tell us these stories of women in the Nazi killing fields. Please welcome her.
Okay, how is that? Can you hear me? All right, let me just wet my whistle for a second. Thank you very much for inviting me to Sonoma State University. It's really a pleasure to be here. This is my first time on campus. I've heard wonderful things about this university from some of my colleagues who have also given lectures here in your series. I want to congratulate you on the Alliance for the Study of the Holocaust and Genocide. I just heard that it's been in existence for 30 years. That is remarkable, and it's something that all of you as students and members of this community here at Sonoma State should be extremely proud. I also want to thank Pearl and David Furman for underwriting my talk today in memory of Ruth and Gussie and Edward Furman. Today, if you don't know, is one of the official days of remembrance of the Holocaust, Yom HaShoah, and it's being observed in Washington at the Holocaust Museum, or it was today. And it will be the rest of this week. So the timing of my lecture tonight is not coincidental. This is a moment, this is a time in history, as you know, in the end of April when the Jews started to fight back in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. And that's what we're commemorating in these days of remembrance of the Holocaust at the end of April, the early part of May. Thank you also to Professor Parnes and to Professor Myrna Goodman, is that right? Sorry. I just had the chance to meet her as well today, and I just really pleased to have that opportunity. Okay, so what I would like to do, I can't tell you the full story of, I can't repeat the contents of my book. That would be overwhelming. We'd all be exhausted. So on this occasion, I just thought it might make sense to give you some of the highlights and leave some time for questions. So I'm going to talk for about 40 minutes, give you some of the, tell you the story basically of how the book came to be, how it emerged and evolved over many years. And then at the end of my story about the emergence of the book and some decisions I made along the way in putting it together, I'd like to read a passage from the book, from the epilogue. Now, my research in female history, in female witnesses to and perpetrators of the Holocaust, actually began in a town that I'm sure none of you have heard of, Zhytomyr, Ukraine. Does the name of this town? Oh, very good. Right, there are two ways to pronounce it. And it is, as you know, since you know this town, it's about 100 miles west of Kiev in what was the heart of the Jewish Pale of Settlement. It's a really important part in Jewish history of Eastern Europe and of the Tsarist Empire. This is where the population was concentrated in what were basically reservations, and Jews in the Russian Empire were subjected to all forms of discrimination, including restrictions of residence. And so the town of Zhytomyr was in the center of this history geographically. And if you fast forward from kind of the 18th century, when this Jewish reservation, the Pale of Settlement, came into existence, to the Holocaust, then you would understand that the implications of that these are areas that were densely populated by Jews. And in Nazi thinking, they were then the targets. These communities became, you know, priority targets when the mass killing operations began in the summer of 1941. So, at the time when I started my research in the early 1990s, I was going to graduate school, and my advisor, Professor Richard Brightman, had just written a book called Heinrich Himmler, The Architect of Genocide. And in the early 90s, the debate that was really raging in the field, in what we call the historiography, was on the decision-making process and whether or not we could find in the archives a document, a smoking gun document, that Hitler had signed an order to begin the mass killing phase of what the Nazis called the final solution to the Jewish question. So my advisor had written this book on Himmler and had made this argument that Himmler was very instrumental. We didn't find this smoking gun order that Hitler had, you know, that we thought Hitler might have signed. It turns out we didn't really need this order to tell the history of the Holocaust, because as you're going to learn this afternoon, there were many who followed Hitler, who worked towards the Führer, who anticipated his needs, who knew exactly what needed to be done, including ordinary women. So I decided to go to Zhytomyr, Ukraine, of all places, in the summer of 1992, because first of all, I could get there. The Soviet Union had collapsed, and suddenly the archives that had been behind the Iron Curtain, as it were, documents that we could not access, you know, since the end of the Second World War, were now available to researchers and including doctoral students like myself. And I thought, if I could go to a place like Zhytomyr, Ukraine, which is where Heinrich Himmler had his headquarters. Heinrich Himmler, as you know, was the second man, kind of the deputy to the Führer, in charge of all matters of the SS and police, basically the main executor of the final solution. He was in charge of the camps and all of the SS special operation units and ordinary policemen who were the prime perpetrators. So I thought, if I go to Zhytomyr, Ukraine, to the regional archives, maybe there are captured German records there that didn't make their way to the archives in Berlin or in Washington. Maybe there was that Hitler order, because not only was Heinrich Himmler in this town of Zhytomyr, but just south of him in the town of Vinnytsia, Hitler had his headquarters. And then nearby there, Hermann Göring had his headquarters. So the very top leadership of the Nazi regime had set themselves up in kind of grand style in this southern sector in Ukraine. And this was they were going to turn this whole region into what they call their Aryan Lebensraum, their living space. And they were going to turn this into a kind of a Nazi playground. And that's why they started with these massive installations, these compounds that they were constructing. And of course, in their thinking, the first thing that needed to be done in order to pursue this utopian imperial dream was to cleanse the territory or rid the territory of dangerous elements. This is their thinking, and primarily, you know, starting with of the Jews. Now, when I got to this archive, I started to uncover some really interesting documentation, like this one. And again, at this point, I had no idea that I was going to write a book about women. I ended up writing a dissertation called Nazi Empire Building and the Holocaust in Ukraine that was about decision-making and how it goes up and down the hierarchy of the Nazi system. So it was that kind of an analysis. We didn't go to Zhytomyr looking for women, but I found them. And I really didn't know what to do with them when I found them. So it took years for me to kind of put the story together. So something like this, right? This is a German document. It says Geheim, if you know any German secret, you know, these are secret documents. This is 1943. This one is actually from Riga, which is actually in the Baltics and in Latvia. But this is the kind of material I found. These are women listed, Fräulein Grina, Giernevai, Fräulein Haase, Frau Berger. And then it's you're describing them as secretaries and telephone operators. So suddenly I'm seeing Fräulein, which is young women, single women, and they're in the outposts. They're not back in Germany. They're out in places like Riga and Minsk and Kiev, and they're working in these Nazi offices in the occupation system. And this particular document's interesting because it's telling these young women to destroy during the evacuation when the Red Army came in and pushed the Germans out, telling these young female secretaries to destroy the documentation in the office, the most secret documentation in the office. So they're involved, you could say they're involved in the cover-up, right? They're involved in the destruction of evidence of the Holocaust, so they're not only, you know, most likely reading it or involved in the kind of the creation of that documentation and those orders that put things in motion and actually lead to the implementation of these mass crimes. But on the way out, they're involved in the destruction of that very evidence. Then when I went back to the archives in National Archives in Washington, D.C., the archives at the Holocaust Museum, which opened its doors in 1993, and then in Berlin and different places in the West, I started to notice that thousands of women, ordinary women, were being called to testify from the Nuremberg trials forward as witnesses, and many were very forthcoming since prosecutors were more interested in the heinous crimes of their male colleagues and husbands. We had not questioned their testimony. Why did these ordinary young women know so much? Plus, many of the women who described what they saw and experienced remained callous and cavalier in their recountings. One former kindergarten teacher in Ukraine begrudged that Jewish thing during the war. She and her female colleagues had been briefed as they crossed the border from Germany into the Eastern Occupied Zones in 1942, and she remembered that a Nazi official in a gold brownish uniform had reassured them that they should not be afraid when they hear gunfire. He said, quote, "Just a few Jews are being shot." I became curious about what had been written thus far on the topic of women in the Holocaust or women in Nazi Germany, so now I started to go back to the published literature to see if I could find, you know, if I could find out more about these secretaries. Maybe somebody else had done research on this. And what did I find? I found that most of the portraits of women, ordinary German women in the Nazi system, if they had anything to do with the Holocaust, then they appeared as camp guards. People like Irma Graese, the so-called beautiful beast at Belsen, Hermana Braunsteiner, the mayor from Majdanek. And these portraits were actually caricatures, often pornographic distortions, which, as historian Claudia Kunz observed, sensationalized Nazism by locating evil in eroticized women, right? So the women who are portrayed as violent are the explanation for that is that it must be their biological impulses or their sexual kind of impulses that are driving that. They couldn't possibly be anti-Semitic or politically, you know, they're not political revolutionaries attached to this movement. They're acting out of their biological impulses. And then I also found another portrait of women in Nazi Germany. It was the almost the polar opposite. And that was of women who were victims of the regime, who were passive and only valued for their reproductive ability as Hitler's baby machines. And where did women fit into the growing literature in the Holocaust, which was really taking off in the 1990s? In deep studies, some of them I think you've been listening, you know, you've studied this semester, works by Christopher Browning, so-called Ordinary Men. Even if you go back to Hannah Arendt's portrait of Eichmann, the banal bureaucrat, Daniel Goldhagen, his work on the eliminationist anti-Semite, the kind of sadistic Jew hater. There were studies of men in all the professions who were involved in this, the doctors, the Nazi doctors, the Nazi technocrats. So as the studies of male perpetration of the Holocaust were becoming really quite nuanced and detailed, there was nothing comparable in studies of German women. As I mentioned, we mostly had that portrait of the camp guard or of the nurse who was involved in the mass murders in the euthanasia facilities. Did it make sense to study evil and cruelty as a gendered phenomenon? If we presume a female nature of innocence, do we end up removing women from the history of genocide and losing sight of genocide as a human problem of behavior that applies to men as well as women? In historian Ann Taylor Allen's words, women, while they remain in the female sphere, are thus endowed with innocence of the crimes of the modern state, but at the price of being placed outside of modernity, and indeed outside of history itself. I started to see a blind spot, which over time became a glaring omission. The documents that I had uncovered initially in 1992 in Ukraine, and I started to collect from other archives, innocuous kinds of personnel lists showing that ordinary German women were arriving in these outposts, employed as kindergarten teachers, as secretaries, as nurses, as there were journalists. There were female women, ordinary women, who were like showgirls. Like we had the USO, that version of it, in the Second World War. So they were actually on the scene in a whole variety of professions. And I found that I could put them on the map. Oh, here's a. I had to use a lot of photographic research. Writing women's histories is complicated because they're appearing in the documentation in these kinds of personnel lists, but it's hard to dig up, more deeper stories based on that. I could put them in the system, but it was difficult to find that much more information about them. It wasn't until the last 10 or 15 years when women started to write memoirs about their time in the war that I could start to get into deeper biographies, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But one way that I could try to place German women on the map of the Eastern Territories, the killing fields of the Holocaust, the bloodlands of Eastern Europe, as Timothy Snyder calls them, was to look at photographs, right? Incontrovertible evidence, picture's worth a thousand words, they say, right? Look at these German nurses who are enthusiastically or kind of greeting Hitler and the military personnel who are also very excited with their Leica cameras taking these snapshots. And there's enormous amounts of photographic evidence from the Holocaust. There's something like 80,000 photos that are archived at the Holocaust Museum, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. Ordinary German soldiers were encouraged to bring their cameras to the East because they were told that they were making history and that they should document it for all time. So here we have a picture of these nurses greeting Hitler. This is August 41. This is a key time in the history of the Holocaust. Berdichev, another center of Jewish life. In a few weeks, that community is going to be wiped out during the ghettoization and then the mass shootings of September 41. And there are some of my women. And even some of these standard books, which I often use in my teaching, because these are German testimonies that have been translated into English. Here we have the staff of Treblinka, including the cook. And classic caption, there's a woman sitting there, unknown woman, right? So this, I want to know, who is this woman? Why is she there? Did she get involved in any way? What did she see? What can she tell us? Then down below, another picture, and often the women are, this is interesting because this looks like almost like an official portrait, a staff portrait. Most of the pictures that include women, these snapshots are showing them in kind of informal settings, kind of recreating, and that's also part of the story. So the files started to grow, and I started to place women on the map of Eastern Europe, and when I refer to Eastern Europe, I'm referring to this territory, the gray area, and the farthest advance of the German army, Stalingrad, you can see to the east there. Most of my work focused on Ukraine, the Reich Commissariat Ukraine, Belarus, the Ostland, that's Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, and Nazi-occupied Poland. But there's so much more work to be done because I didn't get into the role of German women in other parts of occupied Europe, in what was Yugoslavia, when they went into Hungary later on in 44. And what about non-German women, right? What about the collaboration of Romanian women, Ukrainian women, Hungarian women? So there's so much more work to be done on this. There's a lot more work to be done. 640,000 German women joined the Red Cross, and 400,000 of them were in the occupation zones. 500,000 women joined the Wehrmacht, the army, in support positions. There were 30,000 women working in Himmler's SS and police offices. 10,000 women as secretaries in Ukraine and in the Baltics. Just 3,000 women alone were teachers in Poland, just to give you an example of the magnitude of this. There were many shocking moments as I started to dig deeper into this story, interviewing witnesses, contacting men and women whom I suspected of mass murder or as accomplices of mass murder, conversations with people who carried out or witnessed the murder, the many bystanders and those involved with investigations after the war. One of the outstanding cases in the book, and in fact, when I came across this in the archives in 2005 in Washington, this pretty much convinced me that I needed to write this book. I wasn't sure how I was going to shape this material into some sort of study, but this case was so shocking and so revealing in many ways. This is Erna Petrie. This is her mugshot here, the photo of her. She was arrested in 1961. She was arrested in August 1961 by the East German police, the Stasi. This is the month that the Berlin Wall went up, so this is during the Cold War. And the interesting thing about this case is that her husband had already been arrested. And it was a case in which a husband and wife were both put on trial, both convicted for carrying out crimes of the Holocaust, including murdering Jewish youth, men and boys, and not in the camp system, but on their farm in Western Ukraine. They had a kind of plantation that they were running, and they set up their own little killing site on that farm. Someone like Erna was the worst, but her crimes are not the full story, and the intent of my book was not to shock readers into a numb state of disbelief or to repulse, but to explain, understand, not condone, how someone like Erna, who shot 6 Jewish children, and many more like her, did what they did, and to reconstruct the historical era, to define the actual settings and experiences that shaped these young women's convictions and actions. As a German patriot sent to the East to carry out Hitler's revolution, including his colonial genocidal projects, Erna was ordinary, representative of a lost generation of German women. I call them the post-World War I baby boomers, because nearly all the women featured in my study were born in 1920-21. That means they came of age in the 1930s. So as I put these lists together and I was plugging in their birth dates, I realized, oh my gosh, they're all born about the same time. This is a generational story. That's something I can kind of, you know, dig into analytically and say, okay, they've got a common experience in the 1920s. They're the first generation to get to actually become involved in the political system, because like in America, the suffragettes became, you know, they succeeded after the First World War and women gained the vote. It was a very exciting time. And in the 1930s, they really were the first generation to go through the Nazi education system, go through the Hitler youth movement for girls and for boys, and really the impact of that indoctrination was most profound for this generation. Now, Hitler had propagated, and you can see a classic Nazi image here, that a woman's place was in the home as well as in the movement. He even stated at a Nuremberg rally in 1934, "For the nationalist socialist community of the folk was established on a firm basis precisely because millions of women became our most loyal, fanatical fellow combatants." One must take Nazi propaganda and the declarations of Nazi leaders, must view them with some suspicion, because, you know, the aim of propaganda is to inform and mobilize ordinary Germans. The aim was that. It was kind of wish fulfillment. This was their projection of their ideal of the perfect Aryan man and woman. But the reality is that after 1935, the birth rate declined in Germany, so these ordinary young women were not Hitler's baby machines, and the divorce rate actually increased. So statistics show that most German women were not married, were not constantly pregnant, and not staying at home. German women who felt empowered by the movement did not see themselves as feminists who wished to challenge the patriarchy, but as agents of a conservative racist revolution. They were political despite themselves. In fact, the women question was not shelved, but refashioned in the Nazi era. The private became political, and the tentacles of the movement reached into the home and pulled women and girls out to the streets in public rallies and parades, to labor assignments on farms and gatherings in summer camps, marching exercises, medical examinations, flag-raising ceremonies. So this was a very exhilarating time for those who were accepted into this so-called Aryan community. There were a lot of opportunities for them that opened up. In many of the interviews I conducted when I was living in Munich, writing this book from 2007 until 2012, and when I spoke with some of the women, including those featured in my book, and read the memoirs, I was struck by a constant leitmotif that kept coming up. They kept saying, oh, I really wanted to make something of myself. I wanted to become somebody. And that sounds like a cliche to us, and we tell our offspring that, our sons and daughters go out there and change the world and make something, self-actualize, right? We mean it, of course, in a positive sense. But these women had that same sentiment, that same outlook. And for a young woman in the 1930s, post-World War I, to have that perspective, because most of the women in my book had not left their hometowns before they went east, for instance, it was the first time they were able to don a uniform. This was a big transformative moment when they looked at themselves in the mirror and they're wearing a uniform attached to their regime. So this was pretty revolutionary, this way, this outlook that they that really inspired them, and for some of them incited some of the criminal actions that they inflicted on the population of Eastern Europe. Here you have a recruiting poster, "The East Needs You," directed at young German women and girls to go work as welfare workers in the Wartheland in Poland. Here are the nurses being sworn in Berlin, so you can just see the volume there and they hold the pageantry of that. Here's a picture of Erna, which I was really found very intriguing. I included it in the book because when I mentioned that the women question was refashioned in the Nazi era, I was hinting at this kind of hybrid form of a new woman that you think of from the Weimar period, or even here in the U.S., the flappers, you know, they're roaring 20s, you know, they're being expressive, they have short bobbed haircuts, and they're smoking cigarettes, and they're gonna have a kind of metropolitan, you know, kind of urban attitude, and riding bicycles, for instance, and wearing pants. And here we have Erna in the 1930s, and this just reminded me of that kind of image of the new woman in the 20s. She's not on a bicycle, she's straddling a motorcycle, and the Nazis had these motorcycle clubs. Her husband Horst was in this club. It was all about speed, and this is, she's on the motorcycle with her apron and her hair pulled back. So she's kind of like the new woman. It's a combination of the liberated woman who also has this Hausfrau kind of domesticated value that she's projecting there on her on the motorcycle. With the outbreak of the war in the fall of 1939, the Reich labor leader called for the enlistment of single girls between the ages of 17 and 25 years old. All single women had to report for duty, as it were, during the war, and the labor drive expanded as the war continued, and as you can imagine, as more ordinary German men were falling on the front, the demands for labor became greater, so women were being pulled into all kinds of roles, you know, in an unprecedented way. And this, when Hitler's forces invaded the Soviet Union in the summer of 1941, the labor drive was expanded once again by placing women in war-related industries, offices, and hospitals. Such global ambitions of the Reich required the creation of a new caste of German imperial elites composed of young men and women. At this point in my research and plans for a book, I thought about how best to tell the story of the young women who went east. How can a generational history of this magnitude be written in a manner that does not reduce the variation of individual experiences into a one-dimensional caricature? If I took the collective biography approach, which persons could I include? Whom would I choose? Certainly the availability of source material was decisive. Biographies would allow me to explain the origins of their behavior, their wartime experiences, and their post-war attempts to make sense of what they witnessed and did. I decided to choose 13 biographies, here is one of them, because I realized that if I intertwine them as a generational cohort, I could tell kind of the story of German history in the 20th century, at least from the World War I era to the present. You can see this this one subject is still alive, but through the eyes of German women. And the Nazi era, indeed the Holocaust, would be properly contextualized. Because often studies of the Holocaust, they contract down to, even if you look at the mass killing phase, from 39, you know, to 45, or some, you know, think about courses on the Holocaust. Do they start in 1933 when Hitler was made chancellor, or do they start, you know, earlier than that with the rise of anti-Semitism? You know, so the issue of how to chronologically demarcate the story of the Holocaust, this to me was a new way of understanding its place in modern history through these biographies of these women. And lastly, biography has the added benefit of showing how human beings change. A lot of studies in the Holocaust place the our subjects, using a lot of legal terminology, into victims, perpetrators, and bystanders. And they get kind of frozen in those, locked into those roles, and we don't quite understand them as human beings who, how they got into it, what they did, and how they, in the aftermath, how they were changed by that. And these women changed a lot. They were very adept at slipping in and out of roles over time, and I think, as you'll see in a moment, in a kind of frightening way. I would like to stress that German women who were active in the East responded to and contributed to the violence, and specifically to the Holocaust, in a number of ways. I've chosen a few examples to illustrate how one woman expressed her revulsion and tried to persuade male colleagues not to participate, while other women exploited their power and even chose to kill. Here's my first case. This is Annette Schuking-Hohmeyer. And she is someone I consider, in relative terms, to be kind of a heroine in this study. In fact, her letters and the material that she shared with me when I interviewed her was so rich and so voluminous that there's a professor, I think at Harvard or somewhere, who's actually writing a biography, a full biography of hers. She's a really fascinating woman. These are, and when I met with the women, they often showed their photo albums to me. They were also taking pictures. And so here's a snapshot of where she was stationed, Ukraine, in 1941. Now, Annette Schuking-Hohmeyer hailed from a family of German literary figures stemming back to the 19th century. She herself remarkably completed a law degree at the University of Munster in the 1930s. She had a certain idealism. She thought that maybe if she had a law degree, she might be able to change the system, because she had witnessed the persecution of her own father, who was a member of the Social Democratic Party. She described herself to me as timid, a timid young woman in 1941, but she did have a sense of adventure, and she preferred for her obligatory labor assignment to go to the open spaces of the East rather than fulfill it in a mundane desk or factory job. So in the summer of 1941, she joined the German Red Cross. But she did not was not trained in medical procedures. She was asked to run one of these soldiers' homes in Ukraine. These were places that could be found all across Nazi-occupied Europe. There were about 300 of them in the East. They were retreats where German soldiers going to and from the front socialized with German women, ate German food, and enjoyed cultural activities. And Annette was an ideal fit for this assignment, young, attractive, cultured, hardworking, and very patriotic. She was sent to Novgorod-Volinsk, actually not too far from Zhytomyr, and worked there from October 41 until September 42. And I asked her, before you were sent there, were you briefed specifically, about Nazi policies? She told me she did not need to be informed about why they were at war. There was enough propaganda and plenty of anti-Semitism. On the eve of her departure to Ukraine, she remembered a casual exchange with a friend of hers in Berlin who was a journalist with a daily paper, and he warned her, quote, "Annette, Russia is no place for you. They are killing all the Jews there." And then on the way to her destination in Ukraine, she was traveling by train with her colleague Lily, who was also at this soldier's home, and the train stopped in the town of Brest-Litovsk. Two SS men, or soldiers she didn't know, two German men in uniform, came into their compartment and struck up a conversation with them. all of a sudden, she remembered, one of them told us how he had been ordered to shoot a Jewish woman. Annetta and her companion were horrified, but they didn't say anything. Why did these perpetrators talk about, even boast about, their gruesome deeds, I asked her, and she answered. Oftentimes, conversations with soldiers got personal fast. They were all men who hadn't been around women for a long time. There were the Ukrainian women, of course, but they couldn't talk to them, and they all had an intense need to talk. On another occasion, she said, I was riding in a truck when all of a sudden the driver started telling me that in Kazatin, a village southeast of Kiev, they had allowed several hundred Jews to go hungry for 2 days before shooting them to death because the firing squads had been busy working somewhere else. When she got to Novgorod-Volinsk, a town with about 18,000 inhabitants, half of them Jewish, she was told very kind of matter-of-factly that all the Jews had been killed. And she was given a tour of the town by a German member of the German engineering staff, and as they walked along the Sluch River, he pointed out the spot on the riverbank where 450 Jewish men, women, and children were buried. Annetta, as I mentioned, was one of two women running this Soldatenheim. She kept extremely busy and to her work, focused on her work. Surrounded by thousands of soldiers, she carefully avoided the rough ones in the crowd, SS men and other notorious officials who brandished their whips and pistols. Only after a few weeks in Ukraine, seeing the evidence of mass murder in Novgorod-Volinsk and in Rovno and Kazatin and Zhytomyr, in early November 1941, she wrote home to her mother. She kept all these letters. They're, again, remarkable evidence that now is going to be the basis of another study. And I want to quote what she wrote to her mother. What Papa says is true. People with no moral inhibitions exude a strange odor. I can now pick out these people, and many of them really do smell like blood. Oh, what an enormous slaughterhouse the world is. I made another decision in organizing and writing this book. I introduced the women in the first chapter without giving away too much about their wartime reactions. Because after all, these young women, even the most fanatical, could not have imagined what they would see in the Eastern territories. Only one had traveled beyond her native Germany, and most had not ventured beyond their hometowns. They underwent their own transformations when they went east, where their ideological commitment and character were severely tested. Now I'd like to introduce you to Lieselotte Meyer. Lieselotte Meyer was stationed in the town of Lida, which is in Belarus. There were about 6,000 Jews in that town, 12,000 in the region. She was the executive secretary to the regional governor, a man by the name of Herman Hanweg, who was also in Lida. He brought his wife and children, and they all settled in a kind of German-only community apartment buildings in Lida. Now, Lieselotte, here is Herman Hanweg and his family, the gentleman there on the right. Okay. Lieselotte Meyer came from a small town near Leipzig. She could have worked in an automobile factory, but the pay was better in the East, and so she decided to go to Belarus. She was born in 1920, and she had an accounting degree. She had gone through the youth movement, the Nazi youth movement for girls. So she was had these skills. She was rather adventurous, ambitious. When she got to the orientation in Minsk and met Herman Hanweg, her boss, they fell in love. And they continued to carry on during their, as they were sharing this, running this office in Lida. And so the story about this particular case has many interesting facets, I think. She is an accomplice because she's a secretary, what in Nazi perpetrator studies we talk about desk murderers. Eichmann was a desk murderer. What does that mean? It means that someone is signing the documentation. It's a state-sponsored crime, putting things in motion, making sure the deportation machinery is in full operation. She's doing this in this small town of Lida in Belarus, making sure that the Jewish laborers in the local workshops are delivering, you know, they're forcing them to produce all kinds of products valuable for the war effort, and frankly valuable enriching themselves, exploiting these Jewish laborers for their own personal gain and satisfaction. And the story with Herman Hanweg and Lieselotte is they're experiencing this whole courtship an affair, and he's forcing the laborers to, he's kind of showing off himself, you know, in this wooing of Lizalota by forcing Jewish laborers to make gifts for her, furs and jewelry and leather boxes. And the Jewish community in these workshops, these were Jews who had fled from Vilnius and Kovno, and some of them in the workshops, and they were really some of the most talented craftspeople in Eastern Europe, and including when I talked to Hermann Hohenweg's son, I interviewed him. The reason why I was able to contact him, because he testified after the war against the secretary. Of course, he didn't think very highly of her because the secretary was carrying on with his father and it was the end of his parents' marriage. He had a lot to say about that. But those craftsmen that they were exploiting, imagine this, they made an electric train set for the son, for the kids, in winter of 1942. So the family has all these memories of kind of Christmas on the Eastern Front, and how they, and their interaction with the Jews was part of this, those kind of good old days, and they were regretting, of course, the end of the war, the loss of the war. When the Red Army came in, Hermann Hohenweg and the staff, they fled. He was immediately arrested as he was trying to flee, and brought before a quick kind of kangaroo court, and disappeared in the Soviet system. And the family later found out that he had been killed, executed by the Soviets. Now, Lizalota Meyer was one of the most knowledgeable, as Jewish survivors described her, better informed than many of the officials in the station. And the story here of her role as an accomplice is not only as the desk murderess, who knows exactly what's going to happen when she signs orders. Her boss has given her the authority to sign on his behalf. She can go into the safe in the office where the most valuable things that have been expropriated and stolen from the Jews are locked up, for instance. So it's not only that she is this secretary kind of killer, but how the Holocaust becomes, for what we know of the Holocaust, is kind of becomes a backdrop for this affair that and these kind of recreational everyday experiences of these officials. Let me give you one quick example. This is a survivor who described a kind of a bloodbath that occurred, and you'll understand what I'm getting at. On one Sunday, all the Jews of Lida were called out to go into a nearby forest to clear out rabbits hiding in the bushes and chase them in the direction of a German hunting party of men and women. A group of several hundred men were recruited, Jewish men were recruited for this job. The Jews were marched down the road to the forest in the deep snow, shaking from cold and fear of what they would encounter. Suddenly, a group of winter carriages appeared, including the local commissar Hohenweg and his staff, senior officials, and women wearing beautiful fur coats. They were all drunk, lying around their seats in the carriage, hugging and shouting, their peals of laughter echoing in the distance. The wild Germans mocked the Jews, laughed at them, and struck those nearby with whips. They aimed their rifles and started shooting at the Jews to the raucous pleasure of the staff. The bullets struck some marchers who moved slowly in the snow and then collapsed in pools of blood. When questioned about this after the war, Lizalota Meyer stated that in fact she and her colleagues did go on hunting trips, and she remembered that they were usually on Sundays. Someone like Lizalota Meyer was also, so they're not only because of the proximity issue, right? They're working in these fields as in these roles, and they have the opportunity in some cases not only to enrich themselves, but actually participate in the violence and also participate in selections. Here's a German official here on the right, and there's a woman, a female official standing next. This is Lida. These are from the private photo albums of these ordinary German women and men who were in the field. And this is remarkable that this becomes part of this kind of snapshot culture and family photo album culture. And we have quite a bit of testimony about secretaries standing during these. These are Jews being marched through town in March 1942. You can see the snow. And they are, you know, Lisa Lota at one point pulled a Jewish woman out of that lineup. But she had the power of life and death. She could save someone, right? Pull this Jewish woman out of the lineup because she said, this was my hairstylist and I didn't want her to go to the death pits. Another secretary pulled a woman out of the lineup, out of the March deportation, because she hadn't finished knitting a sweater for her. Here's Herman Honweg, and I don't know this woman. It's not Lisa Lota. It's not his wife. So there's another story to be uncovered. This is a Jewish man, young man. They've chased he's coming out of a hiding place. They're bringing him out. They're about to march him to the edge of this field and kill him and hang him up and put him on display to terrorize the rest of the population. He was a stable hand, and he allegedly stole something. But someone took the picture basically from the angle where I'm standing. The markings up there, the blue ink markings were what the prosecutors marked these photos up after the war. They used these to start cases and to they'd show these photos to during interrogations and try to get more information in these as they questioned Honweg's staff about the crimes. What about the German women who were not working in the administration, like Lieselotte Meyer, who were not officially, you know, they're on official duty, but arrived in the East with their husbands and lovers? They had no business officially to be in the ghettos, and they were not supposed to get mixed up in Nazi policies, which was supposed to be man's work. But it turns out that the wives and mistresses of the SS officers and order police battalion commanders were the worst of the female perpetrators. People like Erna Petrie. People like the woman featured on the cover of my book, the wife of the commandant of the Janowska camp. These are SS files. When they got married, Himmler had to sign off on all these marriage applications because they were the new elite, the new racial elite, and the women whom the men, SS men married, who were to have babies for the future of the Reich, had to conform to certain physiological, you know, measurements and characteristics, and that's why there's a front shot, a profile shot, and a full body shot. But these are valuable files because the women who are applying to marry an SS man, they have to write their own kind of resumes, their own stories. So they're really quite valuable, these records. I want to go back to the story of Erna Petrie. As I mentioned, she was arrested in 1961 and convicted for killing Jewish children, and men, actually. And in that document that I showed you with her mugshot, that was the actual interrogation record. And the prosecutor uncovered the crimes at one particular moment when she confessed, which was pretty remarkable. And now I want to read a little bit from her confession. The interrogator asked Erna about the children whom she confessed to murdering. Where did these children come from? Erna: I do not know exactly where they came from, but I assume that these were children who broke out of a boxcar at the train station. At this time, all remaining Jews who were in several camps were being transported to the extermination camp. She's referring to Sobibor and Belzec. In these transports, often, and especially at the train station, Jews would break out and try to save themselves. These Jews were all naked so that the Ukrainians and Poles living in the area could be distinguished from them. The Jews were easy to recognize. The Jewish children whom I shot wore only clothing shreds or were naked, so I assume that these were Jews who had broken out of these transports. And the prosecutor asked her, why did you shoot the Jewish children? And Erna answered, in those times, as I carried out the shootings, I was barely 25 years old. I was still young and inexperienced. I lived only among SS men who carried out shootings of Jewish persons. I seldom came into contact with other women. In the course of time, I became hardened. I did not want to stand behind the SS men. I wanted to show them that I, as a woman, could conduct myself like a man. So I shot 6 Jewish children. I wanted to prove myself to the men. Besides, in those days in this region, everyone heard that Jewish persons and children were being shot, which also caused me to kill them. I'm unable to grasp at this time how I was in such a state as to conduct myself so brutally and reprehensibly. However, earlier, I had been so conditioned to fascism and the racial laws, which established a view toward the Jewish people, and I was told that I had to destroy the Jews, and it was from this mindset that I came to commit such a brutal act. Erna was released. She was given a life sentence. Hearst, her husband, was given the death penalty. He was guillotined in 1962. Erna was released in 1992 after the wall came down when Germany was reunified. She was released for health reasons, and she died in July 2000. A few months before her death, she enjoyed her 80th birthday, which was a big affair in her hometown. About 200 people appeared at her funeral, the entire village, and many persons whom the family did not recognize. Her children continue to honor the memory of their parents and condemn the injustices of the East German police state, and they keep wartime souvenirs from Ukraine in their Thuringian household, which I visited. I can talk about that later in the Q&A. Now I want to wrap up. How do we make sense of the cruelty and extreme violence of these ordinary German men and women in the Nazi era? And in my book, I get into all kinds of theories and explanations. I kind of survey them, primatologists, psychologists. I really agree with someone you may have met this semester, James Waller, the professor of social psychology, who argues in his book, Becoming Evil, that all men and women have the potential to commit evil acts, but it is our environment and social conditioning that brings out this capability, and it is a minority who go on to the extreme of killing. I also took the observations of a state prosecutor very seriously. This was a man who was in charge of an office in Germany, in West Germany, from 1965 to 2000. He investigated 25,000 perpetrators. His office indicted 159, including the women in my book. And if the women in my book had already died, I started to try to find anyone who had any encounters with them, including prosecutors and defendants, if they were arrested and indicted. He was convinced, this prosecutor, he said, the individuals were not insane. It was the Nazi system that was crazy. He was convinced that many of the thousands of perpetrators whom he investigated had committed the crimes, but these individuals were no longer a threat to society. They were normal, law-abiding citizens in the new democratic Germany. Ostensibly, they were successful chameleons. This is the Petri plantation I referred to near Lviv. Here it is from their wartime photo album. And here it is in 2010 when I went back with my colleagues. After reading thousands of pages of wartime documents, court records, and testimonies, I decided to visit a wartime crime scene. The archival record of Erna Petri's trial contains sketches and photographs of the plantation in western Ukraine. I was not sure what I would find there. I did not know if the place actually still existed or what I would do once I got there. I persuaded two colleagues to join me. We found the location on a local map, a short taxi trip from Lviv heading north. We drove paralleling the same railway lines that had taken close to 250,000 Polish and Ukrainian Jews to the gassing facilities of Belzec and Sobibor. We turned down the same road that Erna Petri took that fateful day when she spotted the Jewish boys who had fled from the boxcar. We entered the long driveway leading to the manor, which had changed from a stately home to a decrepit structure overgrown with weeds. The porch was two pillars with a sagging middle, precariously standing on cinder blocks. Given what I knew, the place felt haunted, but to the poor elderly Ukrainians who eked out an existence there, it was home. The gilded ironwork on the terrace where Petri had served cake and coffee was rusted and flaking like brittle bones crumbling at the joints. Clean laundry was hung there to dry. The women living there immediately appeared when they saw us, strangers in city clothes with cameras, stepping out of a taxi. We walked a few hundred meters in the direction of the location that was described in the court record as the murder site. It was a strip of forest along a gully that divided two fields. I was momentarily distracted by the scene around me, which was picturesque and peaceful. Fields were being harvested by farmers with horse-drawn plows and by hand. A crisp, colorful September sunset illuminated the rolling hills and flashed off several of Ukraine's newly restored church steeples. Every acre was being cultivated except for two weedy swaths, an overgrown graveyard, and the forested gully. The graveyard was an impenetrable mass of thorny bushes. One could descend into the gully, but the prospect was not inviting. Passers-by threw their garbage there, plastic bags, rags, and booze bottles. Or perhaps the rain had carried the water into this crevice, the waste. This is not the only site in Ukraine where mass graves from the Holocaust, the bones and often personal possessions of Jewish victims lie a few meters below a surface covered with weeds, empty bottles, and other refuse. I stood there meditating, praying, and thinking about what had happened there and what those frightened Jewish children, who whimpered when Erna Petrie drew her pistol, might have achieved had they lived. I apparently stood there too long. A Ukrainian peasant with his wool cap, flannel shirt, threadbare jacket, and mended pants accosted me. It was time for me to go. In many ways, Hitler's Furies is about how we fail to reckon with the past, not so much as a historical reconstruction or morality tale, but as evidence of a recurring problem in which we all share responsibility. What are the blind spots and taboos that persist in our retelling of events, in memoirs, and in our national histories? Why does this history continue to haunt us, generations and many miles removed, in places such as Western Ukraine's plantation? The consensus in Holocaust and genocide studies is that the systems that make mass murder possible would not function without the broad participation of society, and yet nearly all histories of the Holocaust leave out half of those who populated that society as if women's history happened somewhere else. It is an illogical approach and puzzling omission. The dramatic stories of these women reveal the darkest side of female activism. They show what can happen when women are mobilized for war and acquiesce in genocide. Thank you. So I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have about the book, research, the Holocaust, whatever. Yes? As I mentioned, I did have an opportunity to meet with the Petrie family. It was very interesting. They live in the same house. There's not much. There was a lot of mobility during the war, but most Germans maintain their family households over generations. So it was pretty easy to kind of track the families down, find them. Probably into the future, it'll be more complicated, more difficult, because they're becoming more mobile population. In any case, so I went to this house. This image was taken at the garage of their farm near Erfurt. It's a village that consists of about one street. And when I met with the children, they, as I alluded to in my talk, they saw themselves as the victims of the East German system, because it was the East Germans who had arrested their parents and took their parents away from them. And they were too young during the war to really grasp what their parents had done, what they were involved in. And they didn't bring that up with me. They wanted to know what material I had. In fact, I had that marriage application. I showed you that picture from the SS files of the women, you know, front, side, full body. So I had Erna Petrie and Horst Petrie's marriage application that had been sitting in the National Archives in Washington, D.C. for 50, 60 years. And those files go back to, have genealogical charts that go back to the 18th century, because it's this very deep racial examination, and their wedding photos and personal essays, and you know, it was about 200 pages, this file. So that was my ration, and that's why they agreed to see me, because I said, I have all this material. And so I went there, and we had coffee and cake, and I'm sitting there, and I can see in the house, you know, things that had been taken from Ukraine, various artworks, furniture, you know, that they brought back with them. And they pulled out their photo albums and showed me these things. But they didn't want to engage with me. And I don't think they, at that point, I don't think they Googled. I didn't hide who I was. I didn't present myself as a Holocaust historian. I present myself as a historian of modern Germany. I don't know how much they knew about me when I got there, but they just didn't want to have that conversation with me about the wartime period. That to them was just a kind of taboo topic. They were very focused on getting trying to preserve the memory, positive memory, of their parents. And their parents, Horst was known as a local brute in town, and in fact, Erna's father told her not to marry him. because he was a bit of a thug. He was a rabble-rouser. He started the local chapter of the Nazi Party movement. So she kind of defied the wishes of her father. And by the way, the gun that she used, because this always comes up with the female killers, how did they get weapons? How did they learn how to kill? That weapon came, because you're talking about kind of family context, that was her father's gun from the First World War. And when Erna and Horst were deployed to Western Ukraine, you know, to the Wild East, her father said, you know, it's dangerous there, take this gun. And that was the gun she kept in her bureau. And the killing of the children, that day when she encountered them, she found them in the field of their estate, and she brought them back to the house and waited for her husband to come back, because he usually carried out that deed, but he didn't come back. So then she went up to her bureau, her dresser, and got that gun out that her father had given her, and brought those children to this little site on their plantation that had become a kind of mass grave. So that story came out of the interrogation. To what extent the children knew that level of detail, I don't know, because the East German trial was fairly was not highly publicized. You know, they didn't have access to the interrogations and documentation itself. They just were trying to get their mom, you know, out of jail. They petitioned George Bush Sr., they petitioned Gorbachev, they petitioned Helmut Kohl, the Chancellor of Germany, to get their mother out of jail. So in my study, in my research, what I found really alarming and important for the study of genocide, history of genocide, is that the women who killed in my study were not trained to kill, and they're not following orders. So at what point does the violence become so much a part of the culture of that system that it is, you know, people, there's not only a culture of impunity, but what we think of as ordinary women who, you know, we think of women as nurturing, as kind of peace-loving, as being the kind of check against that unbridled violence. So this regime got to this, you know, they're internalizing the hate, the anti-Semitism, the nationalism, imperialistic nationalism, the anti-Bolshevism, because they kind of looked at Jews with a broad brush of as all Bolshevik kind of criminals. And I mean, so when people like Erna and some of the other women I spoke about start to believe in this and believe that they are acting out on a revolution and demonstrating their commitment to the regime by taking matters into their own hands, by shooting these Jewish children, completely outside of institutional structures, in a private domestic setting, that shows us how far this can go. Are you talking about interactions with like Ukrainian peasants and non-Germans or? Oh yeah. The question was the attitudes of ordinary kind of Ukrainians today, Poles, Czechs. You know, when I would do field work, I go to Ukraine mostly a couple times a year, and I've collected testimonies from peasants, witnesses, former, you know. Most of them now have been children during the war. And, you know, that's important when you collect testimony. What age group are you talking about in terms of when they witness something? So that's a whole other complex of challenges and of the way we look at it. And so these were youngsters, 10, 12, 13, maybe 14, who were not recruited to the Red Army. They were left behind with their families. I mean, the occupation
population, the demographic of that, was mostly elderly women and children, right? And I mean, the civilian population that the Germans lorded over. And so these youngsters would be working in fields, you know, herding animals or bringing in the wheat or somehow, you know, working in gardens and that, those kinds of tasks. And, you know, these mass shootings were carried out in broad daylight in these fields. I mean, the Nazis, the environmental history of this is fascinating in a way, because they really put nature to work. I mean, the Babi Yar story, 30,000 plus Jews who were gunned down in the ravine of Babi Yar outside of Kiev. There were many Babi Yars in Ukraine, not of that scale, 30,000, but this was a classic German approach to use that, you know, why dig a ditch if you have a ravine, or, you know, and why not just push them into the river? And we know this from the history of genocide in Rwanda, for instance, how much nature is put to work. So when you have mass murder occurring on that scale in an open setting, in these natural settings, you have many more witnesses. And these were youngsters who were working in those fields. And they're describing again and again, you know, crouching down and kind of looking and seeing their former neighbors being marched to these killing sites, being shocked, you know, by the fact, first of all, that often they were, the neighbors were forced to take their clothes off. You know, just so for a young person to see that and then the violence that followed, or to see former classmates, people they knew, and try and understand that. So when they tell their stories, they're often quite still, I think, kind of traumatized by what they saw, and they weren't given the chance during the Soviet period to really talk about these things openly, because the Soviet regime tried to universalize the victims and talk about all peaceful Soviet citizens who suffered during the Great Patriotic War. They don't want to grant any kind of uniqueness or specificity to the plight of the Jews, of the Holocaust, the way that we understand it. So, I mean, that's changing now, but these witnesses who grew up with that, now, you know, it's kind of like decades later, this opening that they can talk about these things. And the first time I went there, I couldn't, when people learned that I had, at the time I was a consultant for the Holocaust Museum, and they found out that I was in town, and that I was somehow connected with this institution in Washington, and I would work in the archives during the day, and it was like a parade of people just knocking on the door, just kept coming over. I want to tell you about my friend I went to school with. I want to tell you about my teacher. I want to tell you about, you know, this person I was close to, and I saw this, and I saw that. So it's, that material is being collected now systematically by interestingly enough, by a French priest. His name is Father Desbois. He wrote a book called Holocaust by Bullets. And he's identified hundreds of mass grave sites, collected thousands of witness testimonies from this. You know, he's rushing around trying to get this together as much as possible. And I encourage you to go to their website. These are great resources for teaching and for doing research, because they've translated a lot of these testimonies to all audio, video testimony, and they have transcripts with these Ukrainian, Belarusian, Romanian peasants. The organization is called Yahad and Unum. It's headquartered in Paris. It's a remarkable program. Because many of these witnesses to the Holocaust are passing, and we know the survivors every day, that organization, I just want to just add at the end here, Yahad and Unum, they also have a YouTube video. They've started to interview Yazidi children. They're starting to use the testimony collection techniques that they've developed with Holocaust, you know, witnesses to Holocaust, and they were in northern Iraq collecting testimony with that group now that's been targeted and inflicted by the horrors of genocide. So anyway, just... Yahad, Y-A-H-A-D, Yahad in Unum, U-N-U-M, and then it's Father Patrick Desbois. If you Google Patrick Desbois, which is spelled D-E-S-B-O-I-S, you'll get tons of hits. He's been on CBS, he's been featured in the media. I don't have any personal familial connection to this history. I don't come from a family of witnesses, bystanders, victims. I was interested in the history because it's our history as human beings. It's the most important chapter that we know of in human history of genocide, and there's so much documentation that has been left to us to mine and study, and it helps us understand this history more broadly and how it's unfolding currently. And you know, as I would get into the material and do the research, and I mentioned the Petrie case when I went and got into that doc, each time you start to get into this history, you come across a file like that, and you read about, you know, she's confessing to shooting those Jewish children and describing how they whimpered when she shot them. How can one not, you know, how can you read that and just move on to the next file, right? It's just, it's so, I think, compelling emotionally and ethically and just important as a human being to try to understand, get at the bottom of this as much as possible for the sake of those children who never had the advantages that we have to grow up. and also, you know, because there are lessons that we can learn as much as trite as that sounds in studying this history. So I stick with it as a scholar and as a human being. And this particular study of women, you know, I'll admit, as a woman, I, you know, it also motivated me to try to understand this history more deeply. Because many of these women, you know, they had their first chance at participating in a political system, and they felt themselves to be very much part of a revolution. And most of the time, when we look at the history of the rise of women in the Western world in the 20th century, we celebrate it. And it really was alarming to me to see how these women really were very irresponsible with the power that they wielded. And I think, you know, we as women, as we, you know, gain this power, we have to be a little bit more critical of our own history and more aware of what we do with that power. Now, the women that I interviewed and that I studied, you know, most of them, other than Annetta Schuking Holmeyer, who didn't say to me, "I'm so sorry" in those terms of kind of remorse. She just expressed a lot of frustration. "What could I have done?" she kept saying. "What would you have done?" You know. So she just was incredibly, still to this day, just had those kinds of regrets and felt helpless. Although after the war, she became a very important figure. She was part of the women's attorney. She started the Association for Female Attorneys in West Germany. And she was a judge. And she told me stories about, as a judge, how some former perpetrators that she knew from Ukraine would walk into her courtroom and how she dealt with that on either cases having to do with the Second World War or other cases. She obviously recused herself. But she also was sending material to the investigators kind of behind the scenes. She was serving as an important witness in investigations. So there's someone who, you know, didn't articulate maybe what we'd want to hear, but on the other hand, to the best of her ability, tried to, you know, kind of make good on it, you know, try to, you know, see through these investigations and make sure that people were punished who committed these crimes and pursue justice in a way and truth in that way. But no, I, you know, most of the testimony that I read, if you know the German language, they describe themselves, they reflect, they say, "I don't feel myself," it's the use of the reflexive, "I don't feel myself to be guilty. I myself am not guilty. It was the regime. I was part of a state system, and I'm no longer part of that system. So I don't bear personal responsibility for those crimes." Yes, and psychologists I spoke to, because I was really troubled by that, they also tried to explain to me, well, you know, they are engaged in this kind of splitting or identity. If they admitted to the magnitude, one person I interviewed who signed orders, a male perpetrator, he was three people down from Himmler, who's an SS officer, he had signed off on the murder of 70,000 Jews. And I showed him the documentation, and he's, and, you know, kind of was questioning him. And I said, what do you think of this? These were not combatants, because he was trying to explain it to me as a military operation. These were elderly men, women, and children. And he just looked at me and he shrugged. So it was like, this was one of the shrug to me was really kind of indicative of the attitude and just the, I leave that to you to interpret. Well, there was in West Germany, I'm going to focus on West Germany and Austria, the return to normal life took the form of putting women back in their place. What happened during the war was something shameful. There was national shame, and that was not to be, encouraged again. So you see the backlash of that in the immediate post-war period with, a lot of what the propaganda, ironically, that we saw of women in the household domesticated kind of became more of a reality right after the war. Women were also the rubble women who cleaned up the mess of the bombed out cities of Germany. They became martyrs, became kind of in a way heroic for the economic miracle. They were the backbone of that. So whereas the failure of the regime and defeat of the regime could be kind of projected onto the men, the soldier who came home in defeat, the women, became this force in post-war Germany, but again, not, politically active, but just more of a kind of moral fiber, that was what was kind of imposed on them. And there was no reason for them to bring up, if they were involved in these crimes, to kind of come up with a counter-narrative because, it was risky and it was shameful. Absolutely. In fact, the first book I wrote, Nazi Empire Building, the Holocaust in Ukraine, is in large part about that, those so-called Germanization campaigns and the establishment of these colonies in a place called Hegewald, which was in Jitomir, means literally preservation forest. And Himmler had all these blood and soil theories he was applying to the agricultural, kind of pastoral settings of the East. And so, yes, these women were brought in as Nazi Party activists. They were brought into the kindergartens because Himmler sanctioned kidnapping of SS officers. If they saw in Belarus or Poland, if they saw a cute little blonde-haired, blue-eyed boy wandering around, they were authorized to snatch that kid, and in Poland as well, and bring them to one of these settlements, or they would be put up for adoption and end up in German homes. But also, so these women were very much a part of that campaign. And one of these women, there were only two women who were prosecuted at Nuremberg, not at the IMT, not the big trial, but the subsequent trials. And one of them was Herta Oberhauser, who was a doctor, a kind of pseudo-doctor at Ravensbrück, carrying out medical experiments. And the other one was a woman named Inga Wirmitz, who was one of these Germanization experts who was involved in these kidnapping campaigns. So yes, they were, that was part of their role.
So,
Well, you know, the Red Cross is structured as an international and a national, so they're national organizations. So the headquarters in Geneva, and then we all have our national chapters, as it were. So the German Red Cross was complicit because the head of the Red Cross during the Nazi era was a very prominent SS doctor, because the medical profession was pretty, you know, Nazified, because it was part of the racial science, biology becoming destiny and all of that, and experimentation, Mengele, you know. So the Red Cross comes up again and again as kind of complicit. For instance, you know, that was when the individuals were being transported to the gas chambers in Birkenau, and also in Terezin, you know, they used the Red Cross as a way to conceal what they were doing, these Red Cross trucks. So, you know, that history is quite interesting. And the German Red Cross, they conducted their own, put a commission together of historians and conducted their own research, and did their own kind of self-evaluation about 10, 15 years ago. And they determined in that commission determined that the Red Cross wasn't a main agent kind of the Holocaust, you know, in a formal way. But I argue that, you know, when you have the head of the Red Cross is being run by this Gravitz, this very, who was a real Nazi SS leader, the use of the emblem of the Red Cross as a cover for these operations. The fact that, I didn't talk about this tonight, one of my nurses in my book went to the Eastern Front, to the infirmaries where the Wehrmacht, the ordinary German soldiers who in the battle for Moscow were frostbitten and injured and had suffered casualties that were irreversible, and turned them into vegetables or turned them into biologically useless to the regime. There was a unit that was mobilized that went in and started to euthanize them. And so ordinary German, you know, German parents or family members back home would get a note that said, your son or your brother or your father died heroically on the Eastern Front. We don't really know how that person died, or if that person was murdered, if that person died an ordinary death on a battlefield, or was actually murdered, you know, in one of these army lazaretten, one of these army hospitals, which was connected to the Red Cross. Yes. The question has to do with the story I painted tonight is rather bleak in terms of the ordinary German women internalizing the ideology and acting on it and becoming ultimately very kind of evil agents of the regime and violent. Did I encounter any more heroic figures, any acts of resistance? Yes, ordinary German women were part of the resistance. There were also some 7,000 of them were actually persecuted and incarcerated by the regime because they were communists and they were socialists. And many German women, even, you know, because you could be deemed asocial, this was this broad category. This would mean if you're asocial, that you could be a prostitute, you could be an alcoholic, you could be somehow, you know, committed several criminal offenses, and maybe even been denounced for that. Maybe they didn't even carry that out. So there were many ordinary German women who were swept up in the dragnet of the terror regime of the Reich and victimized and sterilized. More than 200,000 German women who were sterilized because they were considered racially unfit and not and should not procreate for the Reich. I'm sorry to report that there aren't a lot of documented cases of resistance, and the few that I did come across were dealt with so harshly. The woman I'm thinking of right now from Ukraine, as the regime is retreating, the war, they're losing the war, she was the wife of a forester. And again, back to the fact that these natural settings are part of the story. And so she knew about these mass murders because they were occurring in the forest, and Jews were fleeing to the forest to find hiding places. So the forests were really a site of a lot of activity. And she was trying to rescue these Jews or warn them when these actions were impending. And someone denounced her, and she was dragged into a German courtroom in Lviv, Lemberg. And she was given the death sentence. And the judge said, "You are an educated woman." He even said, "Your father was a veteran of the First World War. You came from a patriotic household. You should have known better." So women played an important role in the history of rescue in the domestic sphere, because that's mostly where Jews were hidden in domestic settings, and it needed the kind of compliance or the kind of blessing of the female who became the head of household in many of these wartime settings. But women were also involved in the persecution of their domestic help or denouncing neighbors who were hiding Jews. So it's a mixed story. If you look at the files of the righteous Gentiles in Yad Vashem, and you look at all the individuals who have been identified as rescuers, they are predominantly women, but that's because, as I just described, it's happening in this domestic setting. And I don't know how to interpret that in terms of their nature, right? Vis-a-vis men. I'm sorry, I'm not sure if I follow your question. I'm not sure how to respond to that. It's a big question, so I don't really know. Maybe someone can help me out on that. Someone else can follow up with his question and kind of help me clarify. I'm in no way arguing that there's parity there, that the overwhelming majority of the killers were men and in uniform in the SS and police and in the Wehrmacht and in the camp system itself. I'm just trying to fill in the kind of social history of genocide outside of these institutional settings, because that's part of the story too in the history of genocide, and certainly in these cases. We've determined since the collapse of the Soviet Union, people like Father Dubois, who've gone in and identified all these mass grave sites that we didn't know existed. When I started my research, the number that we had for the deaths of Ukrainians, Jews, losses was about 900,000, and now it's 1.5 million. So, and these are undocumented, they're not in German documents. They are done by them, these mobile killing units, but they didn't, they weren't as accurate in their tabulations as they, kind of presented to their bosses in Berlin as being very thorough. They just didn't bother to document them. And there are these cases that I'm describing tonight about outside of the formal chain of command that are occurring. It's just these, settings of violence that are much more varied than we might think. And they involve men and women and the youth and children who become brutalized too. Yes. Uh-huh. That is her friend, another person who worked in the office. That's Frau Apfelbaum. Lisa Lota's here. It's just an illustration, but it's part of the scene that I described when they go on these hunting expeditions, these hunting parties on Sundays, you recall. They occurred on Sundays. These kind of shooting sprees, these wild shooting sprees. So I don't know, you know, if she pulled the trigger and how many she killed. I don't have documentation of that. I know she's part of this grouping of men and women. I do know that she ordered the execution, the killing of Jews who appeared late for work to the workshop that she oversaw with her boss. And that she was able to issue so-called gold cards, labor certificates to Jews, which were life-saving documents. There's only way to avoid the mass shootings was to have that labor ID card. So she had that power of life and death with that, with her, you know, office as a secretary. But I didn't find anything in the interrogations that described her shooting. This woman here, Johanna Altvater, she was in. She was also a secretary. So she was very close to her boss as well, but she didn't have a relationship with him as such or an affair. But she did participate in mass shootings. She was indicted in 1978 for participating in the mass shooting of 7,000 Jews. This woman. So that's a secretary who actually wielded the gun and used it. She was actually acquitted. And the prosecutor I spoke about that I interviewed, because she was dead before I, you know, when I was writing this book, he believed that she committed those crimes, but he said, but she was a peaceful, law-abiding citizen in the New Germany. So she kind of went from being this wild kind of, she thought of herself as a kind of pioneer woman. She was riding around on horseback. She was wearing pants. She was wielding the gun. She would go up to the ghetto gate, hitch her horse to the ghetto gate. She had this whole fantasy of the Wild East. And then when she got back to Germany, this is the chameleon effect. We talk about survivors who come out of this history and rebuild their lives and start over, and the power of that and how remarkable that is. Well, a lot of these perpetrators just started over after the war. You know, it's, the guard history to me is interesting because the forms of violence that they inflicted on the prisoners, it's the documentation now coming out is kind of mixed. We know about some of these horrible cases of, like, Ilse Koch, you know, who allegedly, you know, was taking skin and making lampshade. I mean, just, and she was... really, in many ways, I think she's clouded our vision. She's kind of become this monster, and we've kind of demonized, and in a sexualized way, as I mentioned at the beginning of my talk. But most of the studies now on the camp system, camp guards, are showing that these women, they were like prison guards in that way. They were rough and brutal. The kinds of violence that they inflicted with their bare hands was they used the German shepherds, they used the dogs a lot, they yelled a lot, like terrorized the camp population with like screaming. They used the club a lot, those kinds of beatings. They participated in the system in terms of making sure that selections were carried out inside the camp system. But the most sadistic, I would say, like bare hands killing, weren't really that cohort. Per se, that it's occurring in all different settings. It depends on the individual to a large extent. But I wouldn't say that the entire population of Nazi female guards, which we think is about 4,000, that they were all, you know, these kind of monsters, these sadists. So they're kind of a tricky cohort to look at. And again, they're wearing the uniform, they're trained to be guards, like we train prison guards. which ones kind of went to extremes. It varied, but they weren't trained to go to extremes because the Nazis valued order very much. They wanted to keep the camps very clean and very orderly. That's not that doesn't mean that people didn't suffer in the camps, but I think it's we're going to go back and revisit the camp guard history. There were many more women as camp guards. Now we know. I mean, how many camps do you think there were in the Nazi in occupied Europe? How many camps do you think there were? Just want to ask people. How many detainment sites were in Nazi-dominated Europe during the Second World War? We have 500. Yeah. 40,000. So 40,000 sites for POWs, for children who had been, you know, offspring of slave laborers, for obviously Jewish population, killing centers, I mean, slave forced laborers. So a whole variety of types of sites that were put to different uses. Some lasted for years, some lasted for a few weeks, depending on what the Nazis were trying to do in the war. So it was a massive system. And Himmler said, you know, where there are female prisoners, there should be female guards. So I think this number of 3,500 guards, which is from one document that we found in January 1944, that can't be if the number of camps is that huge. So that I think that whole story, we have to go back. And a lot of people say, you know, when I work in this field, they say, oh, we know all there is to know about the Holocaust. We all feel kind of some familiar sense because of the mass media and films and memorialization and such, that we all kind of know the story. But the reality is that the fact is that most of the documentation is being declassified now. That's how documentation declassification works. It takes 50, 60, 70 years before all the really good stuff, you know, gets declassified. Of course, we captured a lot from the Germans that we've been mining and exploiting for decades. But this is what's, you know, there's just still so much more to work on, and so many more real basic facts that we have to get straight or revisit. Right now, the number of refugees in the world has never been so large as it, you know, since the Second World War, right? So we have a serious refugee crisis right now that's wrapped up in a genocidal war with ISIS. It's very, very complicated and a huge challenge. I mean, most of us are kind of bystanders to all of this, and from afar, you know, we're fortunate to be kind of watching this from afar, but the world is ever smaller. We know we get the information immediately. So we have that ethical responsibility to respond. We can't plead ignorance. And you say, okay, well, what can we do? What can we do? Well, there's a lot you can do. Starting with, if you brought up the refugee crisis, so I'll just mention that. Find out whether or not, if there are any Syrian refugees or refugees in your own community. And are they being getting the support that they need? Because the support can come in all different forms, helping people adapt to new environments and schools and languages. And this is an enormous challenge. And often for people, mostly women and children, who have come out of, you know, fled terror and have suffered grievously. So you could start with your own neighborhood. You look at the numbers that we're supposedly taking in, which have fluctuated. And will probably decrease. Can we live with that number? I can't remember what the latest number is in terms of who would come into the U.S. Is that something that we can live with in our conscience as the right thing to do? So there, you know, there are things that you can do to take action with, you know, your local representatives in your local communities, with your churches, I think, you know, everyone has the power to do something individually, and you hear this often about, you know, you can make a difference. We all get so wrapped up in our day-to-day. I'll be the first to admit, I spent most of my day getting here, and I could, you know, I could have been helping someone, right? So at the end of the day, I say, oh, but we're all, you know, trying to do the work we can. But what, you know, how much do you go out of your comfort zone or out of your routine and say, you know, this is more important, and I want to try to, you know, work on this and try to chip away on this as an individual, and go to bed each night with a good conscience. Doing good is really, really hard work. It's really hard work. The museum in Washington, the director of it, when it was opened, said, Shaika Weinberg, you know, it is a memorial to the victims, but the audience, it's really serving the witnesses and the bystanders. That's the population that most of us are not going to become killers, and most of us, God willing, are not going to become victims. So that's that, you know, that majority population that's so key to how we respond, how we reflect on this history, and the ways we come up with strategies for ameliorating the suffering of others and intervention and prevention. So it's... That's right. I mean, you know, these are environments, the camp environment in particular, but other environments, that did give people the opportunity, as it were, to act out in a violent way. So the capos were taken from within the prisoner population and lorded over other inmates. These are very hierarchical environments, and that's where power, you know, that structure allowed for that. So. Yeah, I mean, if you can imagine, if you are already incarcerated, you know, how much do you have to lose once you get that little bit more power, that extra ration, right? So, and yeah, in the women's camp in Birkenau, there were female capos and all kinds of hierarchies in terms of, you know, the whole system of the prisoner system that was marked, you know, color-coded. So, yeah. She asked about the findings in the book, if I just go with the last question, and to what extent that might change the narrative, the grand narrative, or be incorporated, integrated into general education. Well, the German government, actually, let's start there. My book is translated into 23 languages, mostly European languages, but also Japanese. Anyway, so the German edition, the Ministry for Education and Culture, they subsidize an edition for teachers. So they created, it's like it only costs a couple of euros. It's in what, you know, so it's readily available for educators in Germany. So I thought that was I was very pleased by that. And, you know, my colleagues at Facing History and Ourselves and at the museum in Washington, and people who are in the secondary kind of ed system and doing a lot of teacher training, I've spoken to teachers. It's been, you know, discussed, and I've been going to these seminars. And so I'm hoping that it will become part of the story. And I'm also hoping that I can train graduate students To work on this. I have a couple now. And also to get into the other languages, to get into the Slovakian women, the Polish women, the Romanian women, Lithuanian women, to see to what extent this is, again, back to the question of gender and violence, where does it cross kind of cultural, national lines? And, you know, maybe these women, the German women, were unique in that they thought themselves to be part of the Nazi regime. But, you know, I don't know. We haven't, that's something to be studied in the future. So, yeah. Sir. Those are two great questions. And you're a student here, right? So, of course. That's great. So his questions were, can we distinguish the forms of violence that men and women inflicted? You know, what, like, is there a gender difference in the forms of violence, right? And then the other question had to do with, I focused on a generation of young women. Well, what about the mothers of those young women? Were they part of the these acts as well? There were generational tensions, and the older women, to my knowledge, because they were not going east as much, like they weren't actually working in the system, and they weren't the spouses of the powerful, as it were. They were already kind of settled down, and so I don't have as much evidence for them, but many of them were back in the Reich, back at home. Running the farms and running the households, which were the source of the labor for those households because the men were gone, were these forced laborers, were ordinary Ukrainians and Poles, some Jews. And there's not, that's, an, that has, that work has to be done. That's something, you know, we need to look behind that, you know, scratch a little bit deeper and look a little bit and say, what's going on in those households during the war? In the same way that I described that couple's violence in Western Ukraine. Because, for instance, one woman I interviewed who lived right outside of Dachau, she was there with her mother, and you probably don't realize this because I've been talking a lot about the Holocaust by bullets in the Eastern Territories, but there were Holocaust by bullets, there were mass shootings in Germany itself, and not just at the end of the war when the system imploded, but in 42-43. Several thousand Soviet POWs were brought to the town of the camp of Dachau outside of Munich, and they were shot right outside the camp. And this woman I spoke to was in the house with her mother, and they could hear the gunfire. It was about, 500 yards from their house. And she described a scene where her mother was standing over the kitchen sink, and was so, her nerves were so shot, and she was so frazzled because she just kept hearing that repetition of the gunfire. And then the daughter, the younger one, went with her boyfriend, and they went and they were curious. They said, well, we know these people are being shot, and they went and they wanted to see, you know. So they went later in the day and at night and on the weekend when these things, then they stopped this shooting. And then she described to me what she saw. But my impression was that, you know, in that little anecdote, was that the younger woman, right, she went out to see, you know, and she wanted to go and see. And the proximity in this history is really important. What do people do when they're right there? How do they, you know, do they look the other way? Do they join into the fray? And whereas the mother, who was really distressed, just kind of stayed in the household and, you know, didn't respond in a way. He didn't take any action. So that's just a small example of my sense of kind of a generational split, maybe a potential pattern. I haven't studied that systematically. The forms of violence are important. I found that many of the women who were really brutal killed children. children come up again and again. They're the most vulnerable. It's rare that the women that were killers, that they did kill men. And, you know, for understandable reasons, right? They felt like they could overpower a child. They could gain the trust of a child as a woman. So that was something that I found quite disturbing. And the form of violence, women using guns, using whips, taking pictures, kicking, screaming. I mean, these were some of the descriptions of their behavior. Whereas the men, mostly in uniform, in military formations, in a more kind of formalized way, beating with their hands, punching, obviously using guns, and also descriptions of male violence that was also more sexualized, cutting off the breasts of women, cutting off the genitals of men, like engaging in that kind of violence that was kind of stripping the victims of their sexuality as well through rape as torture and through these other acts.